I'm Kim Lovering. I'm here from the Dutchess County Progressive Action Alliance up in Dutchess County, obviously. Today I have the great pleasure of introducing former State Senator Terry Gipson. Terry has been living in the state of New York for 22 years. He now lives up in Rhinebeck. He teaches at CUNY Pulse right now in the communications department. He's a very well-known face up in my neck of the woods for a few reasons. The most obvious reason being that Terry was elected to state senate in 2012, representing District 41, which is most of Dutchess County and a little bit of Putnam County. It's actually no small feat to be elected as a Democrat up there. Little fun fact, he's the only Democratic state senator in Dutchess and Putnam counties since FDR in 1930. While he was in the Senate, Terry worked really hard for local causes, like sponsoring legislation that ultimately enabled over a dozen municipalities locally to apply for funding for waterfront revitalization. He was a strong advocate for public schools. He led a fight to stop a foreign for-profit testing company from entering New York. And he received a perfect score from the Environmental Advocates of New York, in part, by supporting legislation to increase funding for environmental protection and New York State parks. The reason he's well known is based up in my circles in Dutchess County, though, has more to do with his hands-on engagement with progressive issues like the ones that NYPAN is at NYPAN's core. The first time I met Terry actually was on April 19th, 2016, which many of you probably remember that day, not the best night, but Terry was, along with the teach-out, speaking at a primary party that our NYPAN chapter was having that night. Terry spent a lot of time thinking about and being a strong voice for progressive causes like campaign finance reform, affordable health care, equal rights, fair elections, and public school reform. Although his efforts to unseat Cisbrino in the 2016 election were not ultimately successful, he really did mobilize a lot of progressive groups like my chapter of NYPAN up in Dutchess County because of his obvious passion for these causes. And it's this passion that you can hear when he talks, and that's the reason why I'm really excited to introduce to you guys former State Senator Terry Gipson.
Thank you very much. Tim, thank you for that great introduction. I didn't realize she was going to be here today. I didn't realize there'd be anybody here from West Valley today, so good to have a friend here. Good morning, progressives! Good morning. You know, where I live, it's not that often that I get to be in a room full of just being progressives. Because they're harder to find, believe me. When Controller Natalie earlier was talking about the fact that we can't forget that outside of this room and outside of New York City, there really are places throughout the state, big places, lots of people that don't see eye to eye with us on various issues or on our progressive agenda. I am one of those rare individuals who was fortunate to win a very competitive state senate seat in a fairly red district. And I'm fortunate to have had the opportunity to serve in that great institution. But I was also in the unique position of being one of the Democrats among five that year in 2012 that was elected all at the same time in the sweep along with President Obama's second election, where we actually did take back the majority in the state Senate. We all of a sudden, because of that election, had more Democrats in the state Senate on election day because of my election and four other good Democrats across the state. And by the time we got up to Albany for our first orientation meeting, it became clear that while we were in the majority, we would be serving the next 2 years in the majority. And that was because of the group that has been mentioned here so many times today, the IDC. These rogue Democrats who have actually grown in size, they've doubled in size since I was there. They weren't quite as big then. They're bigger now than they've ever been. They have more power now than they've ever had. And I'm one of those individuals that served in the minority because of what they did. And so believe me, when it comes to ending their reign, there's nobody more committed to that than me. I'm also one of the rare individuals who understands what it's like to have millions and millions and millions of dollars from corporate special interest groups targeted directly at you on television, on the radio, in the mail, on the telephone, at the door, every day. Not just one day, not just 2 days, but every day for not just 1 month, but 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, constantly on Facebook, Twitter, everywhere you look. The corporate special interests have found a way to demonize good Democrats that are running on good progressive issues that would benefit all New Yorkers. And they do it because they have the power to do it, and that's what I want to talk to you about today. But first I want to explain why I'm really here. Why I'm really here is because I served as a local government official in my community in Hudson Valley for 2 terms. So I know what it's like to be at the local government level. I served as a state senator, so I know what it's like to serve at the state legislative level. I've been a small business owner, so I had to work very hard to start a small business from scratch in my basement. I'm a college professor now, and I'm a taxpayer like all of you. And it's in all of those roles that I have observed time and time again that our state government is all too often handing over our power, the power of the people, to the big corporate special interests. And all too often, the people that we elect, in many cases, are handing over the power that we give them to the big corporations. So, I believe it's time that we try to find a way to change that dynamic. And I believe we've got to start at the very top of our state government. And that's why I'm exploring running for governor of New York right now. And I want to talk to you about, why that is, why I think it's absolutely important that we do make this exploration. Hope to achieve the progressive agenda that we're all talking about here today, and we've all been talking about for so long, I do believe it has to start at the very top of the state. And we have to stop handing over, the power that we have to the corporations. When a young man wastes away in jail for a crime that he did not commit, and because he cannot afford bail, the people are not profiting from that. It's the power, it's the big corporations, the power that they have, they're profiting from that. The corporations that build the big prison industrial complex, they're benefiting from that, not us. When a public school in your community is starved for the funds that they need to be able to provide every single child in that school with a quality education, when schools throughout our state are depriving the funds that they need to provide quality education to every single child. It's the big corporations that want to privatize our public school system that are benefiting. It's not the people that are benefiting. When we try to vote and we have to decide whether we're going to vote today or go to work today because we can only do it today during a limited amount of time that day, and we work 2 jobs so we really don't have the time to go vote, when we are denied access to the ballot box because we don't have automatic voter registration like so many states do, we don't have no excuse absentee, we don't have a way to make it easier to vote more than just one day, well, the people are not benefiting from that. It's the big corporations that are benefiting from that. They want to privatize every single aspect of our government, so it's in their best interest that we not be able to vote. And you have to ask yourself, where are they getting that power? I think they're getting it at the very top of our state government. When you, or me, or anyone else decides that they want to be a public servant, and they want to do good for their communities, and they're interested in getting involved in government at any level, and they discover how much money they're going to have to raise to do that, because the corporate special interests have rigged the game in such a way that unless you are connected to them, you can never compete with the millions that they have, because we have laws in this state that allow the corporations to contribute as much money as they want to those candidates that support them. That's true, you know. It's been mentioned today. There is this legislative law that I sponsored and many other people sponsored. sponsored, and we've been trying to get forever, that would close this LLC loophole that would really limit a corporation's ability to contribute to political candidates. But until we do that, they can essentially contribute as much as they want over and over again to the individual candidate, and then they can also give to a political action to become top of that. It's difficult as an individual who doesn't know those people, who isn't connected to the corporate wealth, to be able to compete with that. And you have to ask yourself, why do we continue to live in a state that's like that? As long as we continue to criminalize a natural substance like marijuana, when so many other states are beginning to find ways to legalize the substance, to tax it and benefit from it, and to stop arresting people for using it or selling it, as long as we continue to treat marijuana as a criminal substance, and those who decide that they want to use it or try it as criminals, then it is not the people that are benefiting from that. It is the big corporations, and especially the big pharmaceutical corporations. They want you to have greater access to those things that they call opioids that are devastating our community. Why is it that every single community across this country, across the state, is being devastated by this awful drug? Is it because the people want it that way? No! It's because the people's power has been given to the corporations that make those drugs. And the people who need it less. Many of the people that we elect have been guilty of giving away our power to those big corporations. Now, we're fortunate here today to have great examples of elected officials who do not fit in that category. And I have to say that I am really honored to be standing here in a group of people such as Comptroller Tom Gaffney, Senator Mike Chinaris, who continues to serve as the Deputy Director of the conference that I was a member of, the Grand Conference, your new member of the state legislature, Christine Pellegrino, and many other public servants that are going to be speaking to you today. There are exceptions to these rules, and that's why they're here. And they are going to need our support, continued support, if we're going to win this fight to actually achieve the progressive agenda. But they're also going to need an executive at the top level of our government, that's the governor, to lead them. Now this is a blue state, it's an overwhelmingly blue state. This is not Mississippi. This is not Oklahoma. This is not Texas. This is New York!
Yeah.
This is New York! We have an overwhelming number of progressive Democrats like you throughout this state. We have a state that is overflowing with talent, that is eager to help us move this progressive agenda forward. We have an incredible city like New York City, which has more billionaires living in it than any other city in the world. So we are not short of the financial resources that we need to rebuild our infrastructure, to fund a single payer healthcare plan, to fix the MTA subway, to do just about anything else you can imagine. And yet, we're always short on being able to have the revenue to do that. Why is that? Why is it that we live in a state that has a city with the most billionaires in any place in the world, and we can't seem to ever raise enough money to fund our schools, provide healthcare, fund the MTA, and fix all the other infrastructures coming around us? Why is that? Well, it's because we have a tax code that, yes, believe it or not, as you would imagine by now, the tax code benefits the big corporations, benefits the wealthiest in the state. It does not benefit the people. When you realize that our state tax code has a 2% difference, in what a person who makes $20,000 and a person that makes $1 million only pay about 2% difference in taxes, in the state tax. That's not a progressive tax code. That's not a tax code that's benefiting people. That's a tax code that is denying the rest of us, the rest of the state, the revenue that we desperately need to fund the things that we want to do on this progressive agenda. And why is that? What about housing? How many of us know people or ourselves are constantly struggling to find affordable housing or to stay even in the housing that we have? How can that be so difficult in such a wealthy state? In such a wealthy state, why do we have people living on the streets, struggling to stay in their apartments? why is it so expensive and why can't we seem to solve that problem? It's because the corporations benefit when we keep people locked out of affordable housing. They benefit from that when we don't require that they build affordable housing in their units. People don't benefit from that, and our state government keeps giving that power to the people. When we can't renovate and update our mass transit system so it looks like something we can be proud of in the 21st century, it's the fossil fuel corporations that are benefiting from that. Because the more cars that we drive, and the less buses that we take, or the less trains that we make, the more often those fossil fuel companies are going to benefit. And that's not a benefit to you and me, because you and I understand the benefits of mass transit. We understand that more trains and more buses would be better not only for the environment, better for our communities, better for our lifestyles, and ultimately a much more affordable way to live in the future. A lot of people ask me what I'm most proud of when I get back on my time in the state senate. I'm proud of a couple of things. One of them is that I voted for the DREAM Act.
Yeah.
Now, I voted for the DREAM Act knowing full well that it was the most unpopular legislative item in my state senate district. If I voted for the DREAM Act, I would become entity number one in my senate district because we had done polling, we knew what the issues were, we knew what people on the district like and didn't like, and they were very clear on the fact that they did not want their money being used to provide education to anybody that looked like an immigrant, that was an immigrant, and that was not a citizen of this country just yet. They were absolutely against that. What they don't realize is that by denying access to an affordable education to those individuals, they're actually hurting their own pocketbooks. Because these are people that have the opportunity to become taxpayers, entrepreneurs, oftentimes they're valedictorians in their high schools, people that are already leaders in their communities and have a chance to be strong leaders, so we just help them reach a quality education. And by denying them the DREAM Act, that's what we have done over and over again. I voted for that knowing full well that it was an unpopular item, knowing full well that it would possibly cost me my election, and it did. But you know what I discovered is that standing up and voting for what is right, even when you know it's unpopular within your district, it's okay.
Woo! Yes!
The things that will help the entire state, that will benefit all of the people living in the state, not just now, but in the future. And if we continue to cower in the corner because the polling says that this isn't popular, that the swing voters in your district won't like it, the Republicans won't like it, if we continue to find ways to hide and avoid it, then we're never going to move the state forward. And it's been my observation that too many of our elected officials are doing it, and I believe that the number one official that is doing it is the governor of New York right now. He is terrified to take consistent progressive stances. He's terrified to bring campaign finance to the floor. He's terrified to create greater access to the ballot box. He's terrified to provide the type of tax code reform that we would need to bring in the revenue that we need to fund the MTA. He's terrified of doing all these things because to do that, he would have to take the power away from the Republicans, he would have to take the power away from IDC, and he would have to listen to what the majority of Democrats in the state senate and the majority of Democrats in the state assembly would want to do, because they would all of a sudden be speaking for the power, which they don't have the ability to do now, because the governor and the Republicans and the IDC have taken that power away and given it to the big corporations.
That's why he's going to lose.
So, I wanted here today to explain why I'm exploring running for governor of New York and why I believe that it's directly connected to achieving a progressive agenda. It's directly connected to achieving a progressive agenda because if we don't have a progressive Democrat as governor in a Democratic state, then we cannot expect to achieve that progressive agenda. I talked today about how I truly believe, based on my experience, that our power has been given away, our government has been given away all the provisions. And the reason that I'm exploring running for governor is I want to take that power back. I want to take it back.
Woo!
I want to take it back to you, to me, to your family, to your community, to your school,
yeah!
to your family, to your friends, to your brothers, to your sisters, to your children. I want to lead the way in taking it back. If you want to take it back too,
yeah.
then I would encourage you to contact me, to reach out and join this exploration, because we're going to need a lot of help to it.
Hey!
We're going to need a lot of help to it. I look forward to working with you in any way that I can to take back our government
Woo!
And get busy moving on a progressive forward. So thank you again today for having me here, and I look forward to talking to you more later on today. And thank you for all that you're doing, because it's making a difference. Being here today, being active in your communities, being active in moving this agenda forward is making a big difference. And I know I am incredibly optimistic that when we work together, we will get it done. So thank you very much.
Yeah.